It's so nice when you get back to seeing each other.
Good morning to people in person and to the live stream. I'm Linda Potter, a member of the congregation. I'm also married to Reverend Mike, who's leading us in worship this morning. Wave to the people on the live stream.
Hi.
Say hi to Jarrett.
It's Kevin and Karen, and it's Rich and Ellen, and it's Linda and Mike, and Jarrett. So the sub-zero Arctic blast cut out half of the people who normally come here today. And actually, I heard from Beth Hayes, who was planning on being here, but she came out and her car battery was dead. So that is that. And Carolyn O'Connor is here on the stream. I see we got about 30 people at least joining in on the hour, maybe more. So that's wonderful. And Jared is here playing some lovely music for us and forcing me deeper into spiritual thought than I want to be at this hour of the day. But now that it's 10 o'clock, I'll get it together a little bit. So, just to let you know that our annual meeting of the congregation is next Sunday after church by Zoom at 11:30, which is when our normal fellowship time would take place. So we need 10 members. I think we need about 11 members of the congregation for quorum. I know it's very hard with Zoom, but the annual reports have been mailed out, and hopefully we can move through it pretty quick. We do have some business we have to attend to, and we will need to take some votes. We'd like to have as many people there as possible, certainly, but understand the limitations. We'll get through it, and hopefully next year will be better. there any other announcements from the five of you? Great seeing everyone. Zooming in, I know Andy's there again, and Andy Leffler, so that's great. And lots of other folks that normally are here. Galen tuned in. So let us join together and worship the Lord.
Join me in the bulletin for the responsive call to worship. The world's authority alerts us to the differences between empty power and valid presence.
Jesus' authority.
We come to worship the one true God. Let us pray. Almighty God, we give you thanks this beautiful, though cold, sunny winter morning. We thank you for not only those who have braved the cold to be here, but for all those who are joining us on the live stream, and we welcome them. We ask that your Spirit find us wherever we may reside this morning, that we might be touched by your presence and your Spirit and your power, and we ask for comfort and peace as we move through this winter season. Bless our time together. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. We'll stand and read the prayer of confession. Let us pray. We appreciate the power those whom we influence give us. Wait a minute. What is that supposed to say, Ellen? We appreciate the power those whom we influence give us. Okay, I guess it makes sense. All right, let's start again. I don't want to say garbly gook, you know. We appreciate the power those whom we influence give us, O God. Guide us lest we snatch authority without knowing what we are doing. Teach us to ask the right questions before we give sanctuary to anyone who assumes authority. Grant our power in the principles of the Christian faith. Amen. Hear the good news. A voice cries out in the wilderness, giving knowledge of salvation to God's people by the forgiveness of their sins. By the tender mercy of our God, the dawn will break upon us from on high, giving light to those who sit in darkness and in the shadow of death, guiding our feet into the way of peace. In grace, we will grow and become strong in spirit. Know that you are forgiven and be at peace. Amen. We'll read aloud the profession of faith, which is an insert in the bulletin. It's the Apostles' Creed this morning. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. God forgives us in Christ. Let us be forgiving of each other and ourselves. The peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Please be seated. Nico and Marion have joined us today. What is that, a juice box? Something like that? Apple, right. I've been here 23 years. I didn't know the organ could make some of those sounds. Like what? I said, what did he plug in there next to that? Hey, that was right on. All right. I feel like just saying amen and the heck with the sermon. That was, wow. Right on. All right, well, we can't do that. We're Presbyterians. We have to push on. There has to be a sermon. All right. I hope that, and I'd be interested to know, for those of you that were at home listening, whether that came through okay volume-wise. If it didn't, maybe we need to figure out a way to mic the organ. So if some of you could chime in on the chat, that would be appreciated. The scripture passage today is from the Gospel of Mark. It's the very first chapter. It starts in the 21st verse and goes to the 28th. Hear the word of the Lord. They went to Capernaum. And when the Sabbath came, Jesus entered the synagogue and taught. They were astounded at his teaching, For he taught them as one having authority, and not as the scribes. Just then there was in their synagogue a man with an unclean spirit, and he cried out, "What have you to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God." But Jesus rebuked him, saying, "Be silent and come out of him." And the unclean spirit, convulsing him and crying with a loud voice, came out of him. They were all amazed, and they kept on asking one another, "What is this? A new teaching with authority? He commands even the unclean spirits, and they obey him." At once his fame began to spread throughout the surrounding region of Galilee. Here ends the reading of the word. I would like to speak to you today about perspective, about how we come to have one particular perspective or another, how that perspective may change over time and through different circumstances, or have it shifted even while experiencing the same moment or series of moments. When I was in college, I was fortunate to be introduced to a professor of history by the name of John Kirkland. Dr. Kirkland was an unassuming man, a pipe smoker, and he had a mind as sharp as any I have ever come across. And rare at that college, anyway, he spoke with a tinged, melodic southern accent, which slowed his speech just enough as to create in you a sense of anticipation for each new word he would speak. Now, I was a double major in religion and history, and as soon as I was able, I asked him, and he became my advisor. Kirkland taught all of the upper-level classes, and I took every one. Seminars in Michel Foucault, as well as Frederick Engels and Karl Marx. Yes, to my grandmother's great chagrin, I have read every word of Das Kapital. Scattered among his other courses, Kirkland also introduced me to the works of Max Weber and Emile Durkheim. These latter two, along with Marx, are often credited with founding the discipline we call today sociology, the study of social behavior. He's all right. Oh, yeah, that would not.
You'll have a solo during your sermon.
Actually, that would not be a bad idea. Yeah. Now, he's going to get stuck there. So you can let him crawl. Speaking as a parent, you have to anticipate that he's going to crawl up there and then get stuck or not. Now, what all of these thinkers had in common, and what was particular interest to Kirkland, are the origins, development, and organization of institutions within society, be they political, medical, penal, religious, economic, or social. So, for instance, we can look back and try to identify how society's perspective has changed over time with regard to such things as mental illness. I'm going to use that as an example. Now, in ancient Greece and Rome, a humorist theory was adopted whereby the body was thought to be consisting of four essential fluids or humors, and a deficit or an excess of any one of these fluids was understood to be the cause of any instance of mental or physical affliction. So you had to be in balance. Europe in the Middle Ages inherited this thinking, but they added other causative agents, such as the divine, the magical, and the diabolical. By the end of the 17th century and into the period known as the Enlightenment, mental illness or madness as it was called then, increasingly began to be understood as an organic phenomenon with no connection to the soul, and most people were housed in asylums and treated harshly like animals. By the 19th century, industrialization and population growth led to a massive expansion of the number and size of asylums in every Western country. Though the term psychiatry was coined, those treating people, now called the insane, were known as alienists, a title quite indicative of society's views on the matter. The turn of the 20th century saw the development of psychoanalysis, and asylum inmates became to be increasingly referred to as patients, with asylums being renamed as hospitals. Early in the 20th century in the United States, a mental hygiene movement developed, intended not just to treat, but also to prevent mental disorders. Clinical psychology and social work developed as professions, and by World War II, the first diagnostic and statistical manual of mental disorders, the DSM, was created. Electroconvulsive therapy, lobotomies, and insulin shock therapy came to be used by the mid-century, but beginning in the 1960s, many were beginning to challenge the very concept of mental illness itself. Now, the past 60 years have seen a gradual deinstitutionalization with isolated psychiatric hospitals, like the one in Ogdensburg, being closed down in favor of community mental health services and a new pharmacological approach to treating mental disorders, began a meteoric rise of antipsychotic and antidepressant and anxiety drugs, and which are now among the most prescribed in the world. Though certainly driven by breakthroughs in science and medicine, these changes in the treatment of the mentally ill reveal the historical shifts in society's perspective, not just on treatment, but more importantly, on the social institutions doing the treating and our social understanding of those being treated. Though we've looked only briefly at just one area of society, these same kinds of shifts in perspective have occurred over time in areas of education, in imprisonment, social welfare, religion, citizenry, labor and industry, the list goes on. At the heart of all these changes, though, is the nature and the role of authority. Who has it? From what or where is it derived? And how is it wielded? So in their pioneering work, Weber identified three types of authority within a society. There's traditional authority, power legitimated by respect for long-established cultural patterns. There's charismatic authority, where it has power legitimated by extraordinary personal abilities that inspire devotion and obedience. And then there's rational legal authority, also known as bureaucratic authority, where power is legitimated by legally enacted or mutually agreed upon rules and regulations, such as are seen in governments and in social institutions, including religious institutions. There are, however, other kinds of authority, though similar to Weber's, they're a bit more nuanced and individuated as opposed to these broad stroke categories. So there's earned authority, authority based on expertise, on knowledge, on experience, on training, skill, wisdom, the education one has, or the degrees or job titles that one holds. There's contract authority, authority based on legally binding agreements, but also on informal contracts, where the kind of authority in human relationships is derived from the many understandings that we have as people and that we make with each other in our day-to-day interactions. And then there's personal authority, based on the power one has over another to control, dominate, or coerce them to do what they would not otherwise do. So today's scripture reading from Mark chapter 1 is all about authority, about who has it, who doesn't, and what is done with it. Now remember that Mark is the earliest of the Gospels. So when we're reading Mark, we note that he just doesn't mess around. He just says it. While Matthew and Luke go to some great lengths to talk with extreme flourish about the nativity, including the magi and shepherds and angels, and John, in his gospel, gets all enmeshed in the cosmic preexistence of the Word, the author of Mark takes just 16 verses to lay out Isaiah's prophecy, to have John the Baptist arrive on the scene, to see Jesus baptized, then tempted, find John arrested, and have Jesus proclaim that the time is fulfilled and that the kingdom of God draws near. By the 21st verse of chapter 1, boom, Jesus begins his ministry in this little town called Capernaum, a fishing village on the shores of the Sea of Galilee. Jesus strolls right into the synagogue on the Sabbath, no less, and he just starts to lay it on them. Now, it's important to note, and I'm sure that this was Mark's intent, that Jesus' authority was so obvious, so blatant, so matter of fact, as to be recognized by anyone. It wasn't open for debate, there was no gray area, and it wasn't something that anyone could miss. Mark says that those who heard him were astounded by his teaching, and that he taught them with one who had authority. Now we can infer from the text that this was a different kind of authority, unlike anything that people had seen before. Now, in Weber's terms, Jesus possessed a charismatic authority, surpassing both the traditional authority manifested by the synagogue and the rational legal authority embodied by the scribes. Now, let's be clear. Jesus' authority was firmly established before he rebuked and cast out the unclean spirit from the man. That was just the icing on the cake, but some pretty sweet icing. You see, the unclean spirit, speaking through the man, knew exactly who Jesus was, the Holy One of God. But before it was forced from him and leaving him convulsing and crying with a loud voice, the unclean spirit asks Jesus, "What do you have to do with us?" That is the question we take up this morning. What do you have to do with us? That is the very same question much of society asks of the church, of our church, each and every day. Amid the authority wielded by nations and governments, their armies, their laws and statutes, what do you, the church, have to do with us? How do you matter over and against the social institutions we have created throughout the centuries to control and to dictate education, commerce, healthcare, medicine, the legal system, and social welfare? What difference can you possibly make compared to the technology we create, the laws we enact, the contracts we enforce, and the power that we wield? With your buildings to fix and maintain, your budget deficits to overcome, and the dying of your people, what authority do you have, O church, to even speak to the world, let alone change it? Many years ago, sitting in a seminar room in Martz Hall on the Bucknell University campus, I was listening to John Kirkland talk about Michel Foucault, a French philosopher. And I had an epiphany. What one looks at is certainly important, but how one looks at it, the perspective one takes, is what makes the difference. Next Sunday, during our annual meeting of the congregation, we will have much to consider about the future of our church. though we must keep a responsible perspective on the facts and the figures, on what we can and cannot do, I would also like to encourage us to shift our perspective to consider that no matter what the future brings, we will always be a congregation which speaks to the world as one having authority. Our authority as a church is not in the power we wield over people, but in the power we wield for people. Our authority as a church is derived not from the money we receive, but in the love that we give. Our authority as a church comes not from what we once did, but from what we dare to do next. Our authority as a church comes not from human endeavor or ability, but from the very hand of God and the power of the Holy Spirit. And as I witness just about every week, our authority as a church and as people of faith is unlike anything else in this world. It is the authority of hope, to which we don't just cling, but stand firmly upon in the darkest hours, inspiring us to move with boldness from one moment to the next, and sustaining us so that we might simply take that one next step in whatever direction the journey leads. Ours is the authority of mercy, made real in the tender empathy we offer, expressed in our shoulders so cried upon, and offered in the gifts of compassion we so freely give to each other and to this world. And ours is the authority of grace, which holds fast to the salvation of the cross, the promise of new life in Christ, and the truth of God's love as the only authority this world requires. So let us as a church continue to speak as one having such authority, not only to the world, but let us also speak in this way to each other and to ourselves. And the people were heard to say,
Amen.
Amen. We are a small but mighty band gathered here. Amen. Emphatic amen. It is, how long have we been doing this? Since October, right? So October, November, December, January, 5 months. I'm slowly starting to get the feel of most of the people are there, we're there before the camera moved, and some of the people are here, but we're all here together. Is that shift happening for you as you come on Sunday? You're feeling not just so isolated here, but part of the larger whole? Yes, thank you. Thank you. Chime right in. We're going to ritualize our friendship. We're going to offering is being taken. And I have to say, I'm always amazed every week at the envelopes that come in for Barry Walsh. Barry Walsh gets a lot of mail, and that's a wonderful thing. So thanks to everyone for your support, continued support of the church. And I'm just going to kind of go down here and read. Oh, people are. Melba got up late. She just tuned in. We're not. No questions. Tom's on. Galen's on. Susan Akins is on. Andy, Josh Holbrook, Georgia Vos, Janet Stitt, Jane Cable, Aloha Kakahiaka. I don't know what that means, but she says it's phonetically spaced and spelled. Barry Walsh, good morning. Barry Zoom bombed the deacon's meeting on Thursday. Completely random. But good, kept us on our toes. Krista Lyon. Krista, just so you know, she had an appointment last week and she thought she was going to have a biopsy, but it was just a preliminary meeting. So she is back to the doctor this week on the 3rd, not sure of the time yet, to not only have the biopsy, but to have the mass removed at the same time. The surgeon said that would make the most sense, so we're praying for her at this time. Barb Brown and Ellen and Dave McMaster. Beautiful music, Gene and Pat McGuire, Sandy Pollard, Toots Phillips, Betsy Robinson, Patience, Cameron and Aubs. Nicholas returning to work this week, and thus far it's going well. Anna Brown, all right. Who is now Anna Eller, gotta change that. Barbara Brown, Pat Mace. Pat Mace donated us her toaster oven, and we're just loving it. It makes far better toast, and we're kicking ourselves for having a toaster all these years. Organ sounded beautiful, as did the amazing music before our service. Melba and good morning in Hawaii, Jane says. Thank you, Jane. So nice to have these conversations. Is there anything you'd like to be sharing today or we can be praying for? Let me just check my email real quick. All right. Anything? Anything? Any rumblings in the back? Jim and Andrew, you came in. Good to see you. Nice. Okay. Our son Tucker left this morning at 8 o'clock to go back to college. So Linda, I, and I are officially back into the empty nest. Well, we've always been in the nest. It just wasn't empty. The dining hall at Park Place University is now closed. Hold on. We're praying for Tim Kuhn, Karen Bailey's uncle, having some issues in a nursing home. And is that it? Great, let us pray. Gracious God, we give you thanks this day that you were kind enough to gift us with this bright and brilliant sunshine and blue sky to remind us of the beauty of this earth. Today we lift up in prayer those in need. We ask prayers for Karen's uncle, Tim, as he struggles with issues and life in the nursing home. We pray for Karen Parker doing therapy for balance. We pray for Bob Fraser recovering from surgery. We celebrate that Katie Bennett got her driver's license. We ask prayers for Marie McMaster and her sons David and Ron as they seek to provide appropriate care for her as she ages. We seek prayer for Betty Fraser on the death of her brother David. Prayers for Marilyn Rohde on the death of her big brother Baker Elliott, who turned 96 in December. Prayers for Bill Gollinger and the Gollinger family on the deaths of his aunt and uncle Lillian and Bob in the house fire last week. Pray for Tom Dildine recovering from surgery and the implantation of a pacemaker, and prayers for Kimberly Dildine, who's being treated for a similar cardiac issue. We ask prayers for Carolyn Zonta's brother Art, who has been diagnosed with stage 4 esophageal cancer, living down in Virginia. We ask for your mercies upon Greg Richard, Ray Erickson's daughter Meredith's stepfather-in-law, recovering from surgery to remove a brain tumor. We ask prayers for Katie Holbrook, the sister-in-law of Josh Holbrook, who is suffering ill effects from cancer treatment. And we pray for Josh in this time in his life. We are delighted to hear the news of Jessica Brown and her husband Brian Stumper expecting a baby this winter. The grandparents of Mark and Nancy Brown, we celebrate that Caitlin Grant and her husband Nick are also pregnant, expecting a baby this winter. And we pray for Colleen and Dale, grandparents. And we rejoice at the birth of Chris and Candace Grant's daughter, Quinn. We pray for Courtney Riley and her family on the tragic death of her sister, Catherine. We congratulate Duncan Melville on his stepmom's awarded the Officer of the Most Excellent Order of the British Empire for her work with Scottish veterans. She's a medical doctor. We pray for Nancy Tuttle, who is now living at LaPointe Nursing Home, and we ask that you ease that transition. We pray your mercies upon Beth Hayes as she is suffering with the loss of her brother, Don. We pray and continue to pray for Carrie Whalen, who is doing rehab for a badly fractured wrist and hand after suffering a fall on the ice. We pray for Patience Boswell and all the staff and residents of the Canton Nursing Home. This day we ask that you be with Krista. We ask that you be with Christine Potter, who is suffering still under the effects of COVID, and we ask for strength and healing for her. We ask that you be with those here in the church who have a difficult time with winter. We pray for Bill Rohde, for Bill Webb. We pray for Marty Lyon and Shelley Backus. We pray for Chad. Continued prayers for Arvilla, for Nicholas Boswell, for Nancy, Pastor Donna, Jose, Patrick LaPierre's mom. We pray for Andrew, recovering from a stroke. We pray for those that serve our nation and their families in support of them, and we ask that this church might speak and act with authority in this world, that we may bring comfort and compassion and empathy and grace to this world and to each other in our lives. We ask these things in the name of your Son who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Want to help me do the benediction? Put your hands up. There you go. As you go from this place, keep them up. As you go from this place, be filled with peace, hope, and enjoy the innocence of a child. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine on you, be gracious to you. Keep them up and give you peace. Amen. Thank you.
Have a good week, everybody. Kevin, Karen.